2 for 195, Thorpe 60, Hicks 67. 24 minutes to go for these two England batsmen. They're hanging on grimly. They can get in to the dressing room unscathed tonight, then there will be some very, very interesting nights ahead of the players in both teams. Worries from the Australian point of view, happiness from England. Can we do it? Can we stage one of the greatest fight backs of all time? Pitch is still very good. There are bowler's footmarks there, but the batsmen are playing the ball with their pads when it is landing in those footmarks. Spun a long way, defeated Healy. Can't have come off the pad, otherwise the umpire wouldn't allow the runs, and it's byes. Didn't miss by much.
No, it didn't, and a little frustration creeping into the Aussies out there. You could see Warne just getting a little frustrated with that one. Certainly spun a long way back.
One of the things that indicates this is a very good pitch is that other than the ball landing in the footmarks, nothing is jumping at the batsman. Ball's coming through at nice even height, bail height, but nothing is jumping and forcing hurried strokes.
So I just get the feeling that while he plays at that one, it just may be worthwhile considering someone behind square. It would be a bit of a tragedy from Warne's point of view if a little inside edge hit the pad and then went behind the square. In a situation where they could easily justify a four around the bat, especially in this little lead up to the close of play. But a lot of credit got to go to these batsmen. Thorpe in particular, who had a lot of problems with Warne in the first innings, got out to him, and he obviously has changed his game slightly, stayed off the front foot in the second innings. Two for 197.
Wow, look at this.
2 for 197. Warne is going to continue to Thorpe. Spun a long way. Just having a little talk to Bobby Simpson, and we were talking about the match between the two Australian teams, Australia versus Australia A, and that is the date. Those are the dates there for that that weekend, the Adelaide Oval. And Sunday the 11th is the first time they meet. Well, that was a very good shot. That was short, and he was onto it in a flash. He does play that shot well. And he directs the ball down towards the wicket as opposed to square leg, and that four brings up a 200 as well. So Thorpe getting onto that one in a hurry.
That poses an interesting question for Shane Warne. What he needs to do, now that he knows Thorpe is picking the flipper and pulling it, just needs to bowl it up a bit further, another yard or so. As the odds are that Thorpe will still go for the shot, and then he might be just a little late with it.
It's an intriguing battle, which will be the case, no doubt, in Adelaide as well, on Sunday the 11th. When Australia versus Australia.
And that has almost hit the stumps on the way through. That's the second time Warne has spun the ball a prodigious amount. and Healy has not been able to take it. Very difficult for keepers out there. Ball coming out of the footholds. Healy won't be pleased because he prides himself on no buys. But that wasn't very far away from the stumps.
As you can see the reaction of Healy there, but, it is not easy at all.
Batsman keeps on trying to get himself G'd up there. Thorpe saying, come on, come on, come on. He's only talking to himself.
Bowled.
It's been a great contest. Shane Warne has bowled well, and it's 2 for 203.
Hello there. In National 9 News tonight, delays for thousands of airline passengers as unions warn there's more to come. A father's impassioned plea to parents after the suicide deaths of his children. The ANZ...
65 to Thorpe, 68 to Hick. A useful partnership. This is Warne. Just wouldn't be surprised if he just zips around the wicket for a couple of balls just to change things around a little bit. Although he's really done a lot of trying from around the wicket. Thorpe patting him away. Can't do that quite as readily with Warne over the wicket, so Warne has probably decided that there's more of a chance. Oops, a little bit of chat there, which is probably to Healy or to Boone, I assume. But one can see the frustration building up in Warne out there at the moment. He's bowled a lot of balls to these two. His figure's now 23.2 overs, 2 for 43.
Left-hand, right-hand combination that's worked so well for Australia at the top of the order. Taylor and Slater, it used to be Taylor and Jeff Marsh, is always likely to have an effect on the opposing bowlers in the middle of the order as well. Hick the right-hander and Thorpe the left-hander. Oh, now that's well bowled. That was further up, that flipper. And that's where he needs to bowl it, just where Thorpe might think he could pull it through mid-wicket. He's not quite sure.
Yes, well, he didn't this time, and it was a magnificent delivery. It actually went the other way just a little bit and beat everything. Yep. Another look at the one that beat Thorpe. Oh, and that was well bowled. Oh, and that one didn't bounce at all out of the rough. It stayed right down, and therefore the byes. Two off the over, 2 for 207. Warne to continue, Thorpe on strike. Those close fielders still hovering around him. He'd be very disappointed if he gets out now, having come this far. It's always a very enjoyable evening if you've batted together for a while to go in undefeated. Look forward to the morning. It's been a good performance.
Everything's happening out there now. The tension is great, I can assure you. Fielding side right on their toes and frustrated. The two batsmen just making sure they can waste a little bit of time, just trying to make sure this is the last over, which is not. Warne's trying to get into bowl at Thorpe, and he's not having any of it. just it's the little movement so that you're looking down just as the bowler is starting to run in, and then you have every excuse to step away, wait for him to go back to his mark. Bit of tactical stuff going on now from these two batsmen. A lot of pad play, but they have done a terrific job. Hickenthorpe.
237 minutes they've been out there together. And they've put on 148. Yes, that was a little different. He came charging in, went wide. Have a look at this ball from Warne.
Another good over for the two batsmen, struggling to stay there until stumps, 2 for 207. This one coming up now will be the last over according to the clock on the ground. Atherton out for 23 and Stewart for 33.
Yes, an action-packed last day in front of us. Warne to take up the attack. It's going to be very tough for Thorpe and Hick this morning when you've batted for 4 hours, as he takes his guard there, Graham Thorpe, with his bail. He takes the bail off and marks his guard. Somewhere around about 2 legs. And you've batted for 4 hours with great concentration. The first half hour next morning is the toughest for them. If they can survive the first half hour, get used to the pace of the pitch again, the light, and relax, it should be a great day for cricket. Thorpe, 66 runs off 200 balls, facing Shane Warne, coming over the wicket. And good morning, Greg Chappell.
Good morning, Bill. For what should be a very interesting final day's test cricket here at the GABBA. There may have been a few sleepless nights in the Australian camp last evening, but one wicket can change the whole momentum and the whole course of this test match. And who better to do that than Shane Warne?
It's the first ball of the final day. Well, up it turns, Healy knocks it away. Taylor takes it as swip. Interesting field placing. Boone going from bat pad to a red gully, the ball spinning away from the left-hander. Where he was here yesterday, he's moved a fraction squarer for the red glance, or the one he turns around the corner. Shane Warne giving it much more air and bowling slower. Maybe they had a talk during the break after the game yesterday to decide their tactics. Maybe a bit more flight, throw it higher, it may bounce a bit more, entice the batsman to drive. Wrong. And one question, Greg, they didn't bowl the spinners in tandem for long yesterday.
No, that was interesting, Bill. I felt that it was worthwhile, and I would imagine if we go for any length of time without wickets this morning, there's a very good chance they will bowl in tandem. Not much breeze this morning.
Fine shot. This is the 78th over. Well, the new ball's about 7 overs away, so I would be surprised if May doesn't open for the members in this morning to give the spin twins a chance before the second new ball. Tim May, his right arm off spinners. Where'd that go? I trickled away. Thorpe has every right to do that. The left-hander has that rough, wide of the off stump. If he drives, there's a possibility of a catch. He's aiming for the rough, gets it, and it really spins back sharply.
Yes, they can turn a lot from that rough area. The England batsmen will have to try and play normal cricket as much as possible if they just try and survive. It may bring about their downfall. 2 for 211.
211 is going to be Tim May from the members' end. Right arm off spin to Graham Hick. Confidence between the two batsmen, they are growing in confidence. They'll be aware that they've got a great responsibility. They've taken the attack to the Australian bowlers with good, sensible batting, some good defensive work, some good shots. A record partnership the third wicket between Hick and Thorpe at the GABBA for England. 1-2-4 was the previous partnership between Bill Edridge and Peter May. Not a high partnership for the third wicket at the GABBA. To the line, it was a quicker one, a big shout. Was it the back pad? Umpire Steve Randell not moved.
A flatter delivery here from Shane Warne. Top spinner. Pitch well up. It's gone through, hit the front pad onto the back leg. Hit him outside the line of off stump.
Yes, that saved him. Good decision by umpire Steve Randell. They'll be under a lot of pressure today, the umpires, for the bat pad catches, the LBWs, if the ball stays down. A day of tension here at the GABBA for everybody. Cricket delivery well played by Thorpe, shuffling across and back. He's got a tough job with that rough outside the off stump. Thorpe, he's played sensibly. When he looks down the pitch, Graham Thorpe sees the rough. There it is, just outside the line of the off stump. Three big circles. Second one's a worry. Warne's aiming for it. I think it's good to see Warne over the wicket for start, at least this morning, to the right-hander. Brings the wrong and into play. If he spins it away towards the slip, better chance for an LBW. He's bowling over the wicket. Excellent figures. He has bowled very well indeed. No matter how good you are, Greg, if they're not playing shots, it's difficult to bowl top-order batsmen out.
It is, but it only takes one mistake from the batsman or a good delivery from the bowler, and this is not a bad one. Shane Warne pushing them through a bit at the moment, trying to force Thorpe back. Not turning as much as he expected. Misses the outside edge.
A maiden over, 2 for 213. Crowds building up way to our left here. No sign of rain, but certainly more cover than yesterday, and that on coverage the fast bowlers with the second new ball. The ball can swing here with cloud cover. This is the 82nd over, being bowled by Shane Warne. And if Hick and Thorpe survive the next quarter of an hour, one would think that Mark Taylor would take the second new ball immediately.
I think he must. He really needs to get a breakthrough, unless the spinners have done that for him before the new ball is due. He needs to get a ball that will be also harder, much firmer, more bounce for the spin bowlers to use later.
It's a good shot. Short. I think it was a top spinner rather than a flipper. And hit that pretty well, Graham Hick. It was a good pull of the ball.
Graham Hick's a tall man, so he's got a long reach. Changes the length a bit for Shane Warne, left-hander as well, and a smaller man in Graham Thorpe. So this time just a little bit too short. Graham Hick's too good a player to miss out on those opportunities.
Will he go in the flipper now? He's giving him one to entice the pull shot. No, he doesn't. He pitches in the rough.
Graham Hick used the pads quite a bit yesterday when Shane Warne was bowling around the wicket, but any time he pitches outside the leg stump, there is no chance of an LBW decision, so Graham Hick can kick them away to his heart's content.
Tough day for the umpires, the final day of any test match, particularly when it's turning and there's a possible result. Players will scream for bat pads and LBWs. Cyril Mitchie from South Africa in his fifth test match. Square leg at the moment. Warne trying everything. Half a round arm leg spinner there. It's a time for fitness and concentration on the final day.
The concentration is very important. These two have batted for well over 4 hours yesterday. Even though they've had a night's rest, it takes a toll.
It was a flipper. He played that pretty well, and they take a single. 2 for 219. Pressure is building for Mark Taylor, Greg. He opted to bat for the second time. There's headlines here this morning that Australia doesn't win this match, pressure will come to bear on the Australian skipper.
Yes, there's some pressure on him, but I don't think it's the end of the world, no matter what happens today. He took a decision which he based on all the information he had at his disposal. He decided that the best way to win the game was to bat again.
Good delivery. Shane Warne trying everything. He probably would be a bit stiff, a bit tired. A lot of bowling the last 12 months. Bowl 28.1 overs. The conditions are ideal for him. Fingers do get tired. It's well fired and thought doing a good job. Now the batsman will be under a bit of mental pressure as well here. After 4 hours together yesterday, the hype of last night, the chance that they could save this test match, must be swept very well. But you wake up this morning, now you've got to do all over again, and this time you've got about 6 hours. And I think one of these guys would nearly have to bat all day if England are going to save this match. Neat player, good looking gear. There's a wrong one, but very wide.
That is the difference for these guys, though, Bill, isn't it? They came out yesterday, they just thought they had a test match to save, put as much effort as they can into it. All of a sudden, they put themselves into a position where they can possibly do that. Interestingly enough, the pressure increases then.
Yes, it does, for two reasons. One, if you win a test match, it puts them right, or tie the test match, or draw it, or whatever, brings you back into the series, but also makes you a hero. Overnight, England have been copping a lot of flack for the last... three series against Australia. Lack of fight, lack of determination. Thorpe and Hick have shown all those qualities in this innings. As Shane Warne goes around the wicket, he'll try everything in this spell before the second new ball. This is the 84th over, possibly Shane Warne's last over before the second new ball. He knocked over Mike Atherton the first over after lunch yesterday. There's a change of guard for around the wicket. So Thorpe changing his guard, probably going from middle leg to middle stump, whatever, or he may even go to leg stump, whatever his theory is. Just holding up Shane Warne, getting a little bit frustrated, which is fair enough. A lot of tactics in Test cricket, and one Englishman have used one here in this innings against Warne with the Hick-Thorpe partnership. Number of balls faced. Maiden over, 2 for 219. Back to a lot of tension here at the GABBA, possibly because he's bowling into the breeze. The new ball will be taken, it should be taken from the member's end. This is the 86th over. Warne going around the wicket to Graham Thorpe. Captains feel the second new ball was worth at least 2 wickets. Any type of first-class cricket. The new ball is hard and shiny, getting into the middle order. Thorpe pulls away. Hello, it's a battle of tactics here, and Shane Warne is a little bit temperamental. People are moving behind the side screen. That's fair enough. Moving behind the screen, and I think that's fair enough for your batsmen at this stage. They're starting, still moving up there. Thorpe goes down. In comes Warne. Squeezes it out.
It's always a good idea for a batsman, though, to make the bowler bowl at his rhythm, not let the bowler get into his own rhythm and make you bat faster than you really want to. Get ready when you're ready, be ready when the bowler's ready, but if you're in at all any doubt, just slow him down.
Oh. Yes, Lance Gibbs was a bowler that used to charge in very quickly, turn sometimes half a run and try and force you to face up early. I think also Thorpe is frustrating Shane Warne. He's probably aware that this may be the last over from Warne before the second new ball.
Shane Warne's a very emotional bowler. He's more like a fast bowler in the sense that he builds himself up emotionally to bowl and put a big effort in. I'm not sure that I'd want to be going around upsetting him at all. He bowls well enough at the best of times, but if he gets really involved, he might just produce something even more fantastic.
He's trying everything. See, his head's going back there. Thorpe doing a great job for England, as is Graham Hick. The wing's perfect. In the rough and well played.
Very tight defence there, bat and pad close together, the bat angled down so that the ball is going to go down. With those close catches, you don't need the ball to travel in the air any more than possible.
It's close around the wicket. It has to be well back. And by Steve Rendell.
Unmoved. A lot of turn here, pitching in the rough and really darting back in. Thorpe going well back, but that's probably missing leg stump from that angle and that turn. It's hit him on the outside of the front pad. The umpire's got to be absolutely certain that it's going to hit the stumps.
Struck him outside the line of the off stump as well. That's probably what saved Thorpe. A maiden over. Excitement here at the Gabba, 2 for 219. May continues as the tension mounts at the Gabba on the final day of the first test. 2 for 219 as Jeff Boycott and Tony Gregg take up the commentary.
Thanks, Bill. Well, it really is tense stuff out here in the middle of the Gabba. 2 for 219. Shane Warne is going to continue despite the fact that the new ball is due. Understandably so as well. Round the wicket to Thorpe. He's got one or two to really rip out of the rough. One big shot for LBW, but Thorpe has clearly moved across the crease. His strategy out there at the moment is to make sure that if the ball hits him, it hits him outside the line, or it's going to be turning too much, and therefore missing leg stump. But what an innings he's played so far. 67 not out. A real little battler he is. Problem with fighting away and keeping it out is when you get a full toss like that one, very often you've lost the art of smacking it into the gaps for four. He's forgot what that's like.
Yes, but England know that the most important session is this morning. If they lose early wickets and allow a fresh Australian team to get at new batsmen, then they've got problems. If they can keep the wickets intact till lunchtime, then the problems, the psychological warfare, all goes back onto Australia and particularly their captain, Mark Taylor.
Got him! Well, that's magnificently bowled. Taylor had a word with him and he has struck. Well, that was superb bowling. Now, whether or not it had anything to do with what Taylor had told him, I don't know. But Taylor ran all the way down the ground, came back, and the next ball, he got him.
Well, I think it was almost a yorker. Sort of dipped on him, but it was a very full delivery right up there and he just missed it. There it was a yorker, just missed it. And remember yesterday had difficulty with the yorkers of Craig McDermott, that very full delivery, and it's the breakthrough for Australia. They really needed that. 3 for 219.
Well, Graham Gooch, the new batsman, have a look at that. Highest score, 333. An average of 43. Lots and lots of runs in his career and plenty of experience too. 114 test matches, none more important than this one. He's at the crease now, having waited a long, long time to get out there. And he's going to face the music in the form of Warne. Always tough when you first go in. It's nice to just get that first 15 or 20 minutes behind you, those first few runs, Fari.
Well, this is the key time for Australia. Got a strike at a new batsman.
Now, that Warne dismissal, he played, it seemed to me, over the top of it.
Watch where the ball pitches. That's the key. Right up there, almost yorked him.
I think he might have enjoyed that. He's been working at it for a while, and he does get pumped up. Let's have a look at this from stump vision. You'll see exactly where it goes. Just under the bat here. Down the bat comes. And just a little late on that one, Fari.
Well, he had a problem yesterday with those Yorkers I mentioned from Craig McDermott. So, in future.
What's that? A wicket maiden. The one that the Aussies wanted. 3 for 219. So the partnership has been broken. It was worth. Well, Warne is going to stay around the wicket. Hick, who hasn't faced as much of Warne, certainly not as much as Thorpe faced. It's going to be interesting to see how he goes today against Warne. He's only faced one over of him today. Well, he's got his chance now. Oh, yes, he's got him. That's out. He's got him. It ran off the top of his gloves. Now, we did think that this was a bit of a danger for him. He used the pad away. He did this in the first innings, left his gloves down there. That ball hit the pad, ran over the top of the glove, I reckon, perhaps even a bit of the handle and bat. And Healy was as quick as a flash. You watch this.
Well, he didn't get the bat and gloves out of the way. He stuck the pad there, but it hit the pad onto the gloves, and that's out. That's smart wicket-keeping. Slice of luck, you might say, for Shane Warne, Australia, but you make your luck. And that's the right idea, getting the pad there, but not getting the hands and gloves out of the way. Big trouble, England, 4 for 220.
So Mike Gadding, the other very experienced England batsman out there now, also lots of runs in Test cricket. A big 100, 200 in fact, his top score. Well, he's got Warne to contend with now. He's staying round the wicket to him. What's Gadding going to do?
Well, if he's any sense, he'll play football. If it pitches outside leg stump, he'll pad it off. This was Hick the same. Nothing wrong with padding it off, but look where the bat is. Look where the gloves, you see, and it runs up the gloves, the bat. That's an easy catch in the end. Just because he didn't get the gloves and the bat right out of the way. You've got to lift them over your shoulder, get them out of the way.
Yeah, it's very interesting, that one. It really did. It popped up, actually hit his arm, came back down onto the glove, and then onto the, have a look at this, up she goes onto the glove and bat, and then a very quick reaction there from the wicketkeeper Healy, and that's the end of that. And boy, didn't they enjoy that one. So all of a sudden Warne has 4 for 49.
See, Mike Gatting's doing the same thing. Watch Mike Gatting here. He's padding the ball away, that's right. But look where the bat and gloves are, you see. You've got to get them right out of the way.
Great bowler.
So what a performance this is again by Warne. 31.5 overs, 4 for 49. Whoops. That one bounced a little bit. Well, his figures this morning, 2 for 5. It's 67. Fantastic partnership. And now it's the turn of Gooch and Gatting. That's the rest of the England side. Sitting in front of their dressing room. Warne continuing. So I'm just a little surprised he's staying around the wicket to Gooch. I would have thought that the start back over the wicket would be the way to go first up. Got a chance of an LBW if he does that. He can bowl a more effective flipper from over the wicket.
Well, Graham Gooch played Shane Warne, the best of all the England batsmen, when Australia came to England. That was his highest score, 196 at the Oval. He did a lot of padding to the ball when it pitched outside leg stump. I think you'll see quite a lot of football as Shane Warne goes around the wicket.
Oh, now that's where it's a little dangerous, when the ball bounces like that. Little nod from Gooch there, that could hit the glove and go up. They've got two men in front of square, just try and pick where this hits. Again, you see it's hit his thigh and then run up into his chest and come down quite close to the glove.
Shane Warne going over the wicket now. Not so easy to pad up. Got to be very careful here. I don't think you'll see too much football from over the wicket. 4 for 223.
So Getting and Gooch out there for England. 4 for 226. Warne having a chat to Taylor. He's continuing to talk to his bowlers. He'll wander back to slip. And this is about to be the start of Warne's ninth over this morning. He's got figures of 2 for 5. That's 2 for 5 this morning. 4 for 49 overall in the innings. Around the wicket again to Gatting, perhaps hoping he'll sweep him. Yes, I think that he might end up going back over rather than just for one ball this over. He might decide to do it a little sooner. Either that or he's going to persist with trying to get around the back of his legs. If he pitches it a little further up in the rough out there, Gatting will have to be a bit careful with that padding up. He'll have to make sure he gets his leg right across. Well, that's a good delivery. Well, that's that quicker, flatter one that spins away and can so easily find the outside edge of the bat. Just watch him. It's round arm and it spins away. Gatting has to play at this one and it very nearly hit the shoulder of the bat. There's the one I was talking about. That's the one he's going to try every now and again. Toss it up and bowl it a little wider from very wide of the crease.
Well, any ball he pitches outside leg stump into the rough, he's going to be psychologically a little bit of a problem for Mike Gatting after that first ball at Old Trafford 2 years ago.
It's an example of him using the crease. That time he was close to the stumps. If you remember the ball before, he was very wide. This one he was close. And he's now decided to go back over the wicket. So two balls to go in this over. He's going to try the last two from over the wicket. Yes, that was short and easily played away by Gatting. So one more to him, and just one ball to go in this over. Gooch on strike. Two wickets have fallen this morning. Hick out for 80, Thorpe out for 67. Warne has got all the wickets in the inning so far.
That catch of Ian Healy's gives him 219 victims now in Test cricket, equal with Godfrey Evans, former England wicketkeeper. Oh. Just looking at the England batsman, Rich. A lot of kicking and not much playing at Shane Warne. That certainly can't hurt the leg spinner's frame of mind.
Make him feel on top of the world, I would think. You've got to go out there and bat with common sense. There's a bit of a cliche around in dressing rooms in the cricket world. We'll just see how it goes. Or don't do anything silly. But there's also a little four-letter word comes into it as well.
There's also a three-letter one. It's called bat, and it's given to you to use.
Indeed it is. The four-letter one is fear, and that's not to say the batsman's afraid. He's not afraid of the ball hurting him or anything like that, but it's fear of failure.
Great bowling.
Just take Mike Gatting, for example. He's in this side. There was a fight for position there. Craig White might have got the position. Gatting's one of the older players. if he goes out there and plays his natural game, which he should do, a very good attacking player against spin, and gets out, everyone will say, wow, what do you reckon about that? And the same goes for Graham Gooch. It's
just 17 runs added by England in almost 70 minutes of play. They've lost two wickets. That's hit David Boone, I think, in the back rather than on the helmet.
Now, Graham Gooch is at his best against Shane Warne when he's playing strokes. Gooch has played Warne certainly as well as anyone else, certainly better as regards England's batsman over the last couple of years. And he's very good when he's attacking, playing his shots.
Great ball in Warne.
Interesting watching Graham Gooch. Apparently he doesn't like sitting around. He doesn't know what to do once he's actually got the pads on. It's not so bad when he's there without the pads on, but apparently once he gets the pads on, he doesn't know whether to sit in one spot, get up, walk around. I notice he's had the Walkman on in both the first and second innings.
Well, that's one of the problems for overseas cricketers, that they don't have the benefit of going through the Doug Walters training school of what to do when you're not actually out in the centre.
Not sure if it worked for anybody else but Doug. But certainly a lot of batsmen have trouble working out what to do while they're waiting to go in, middle order players. Graham Gooch, former England captain. And he's coming around the wicket. Tony Greig is with the current England captain, Michael Atherton.
Thank you very much, Ian. Thanks for coming down, Mike. A bit disappointed, I suppose, losing those two, because it was a fantastic partnership.
Yeah, yesterday they gutsed it out really well, I thought. Both played terrifically well under a lot of pressure, showed a lot of guts. Disappointing to lose them both this morning. But we've got two experienced players at the crease at the moment, two good players of spin, and hopefully they can put together a partnership.
Let's go back to the beginning. Very important toss, this one, to win for the Australians.
Yeah, it was disappointing to lose the toss. It was a good wicket first up. It would have been nice to bat on it. The Australians won the toss, batted, made full use of it. We didn't bowl especially well and helped them in that cause.
Yes, I was going to ask you about the bowlers in that first innings. Just watch this delivery from Warne. We've got Gooch on strike at the moment. And that one off the pad. Plenty of pad play out there. Yes, just getting back to your bowlers in that first innings. Gough came through it pretty well. Young bowler, but worked hard at it and eventually came up with the goods.
Yeah, he bowled especially well, I thought. We needed certainly one or two bowlers to bowl well because we were a bit erratic. The Australians were scoring at a fair rate of knots, so we needed somebody to come in for us, and he came up trumps then.
Scored 426, then the big chance came for the batters, and that was very disappointing. I mean, you obviously must be relatively satisfied with your performance in the first innings because you got some runs, but to get 167 after 426 puts yourself in a pretty difficult position.
Yeah, that's the key for us. You know, when we're faced by a big first innings total, we've got to bat well first innings, because if you don't bat well first innings, you put yourself under so much pressure, as we have done in the second innings here, and whilst we're fighting hard here, it makes it a difficult game to save, and really on that wicket, 167 is an unacceptable score.
To May, continuing, getting on strike. Now, one of the things that must have been a bit of a surprise for you, the question is, how much of a surprise? Did you have your thigh pad on when you were told you had to field?
Well, I was out towards the end of our innings, and so I just kept my pads on, really. I didn't take them off in case we were asked to follow on. It didn't totally surprise me. I thought it made some cricket sense, but psychologically, at least we had a better day in the field that day, and it gave us a bit of a lift.
And you then went out there, and they got off to a flyer. I mean, Taylor and Slater in particular, really good opening partnership, left-hand, right-hand combination, and aggressive.
Yeah, they play well together, they run well together, and it's difficult. Bowlers get their line disrupted by having the left-hander, right-hander in, but we decided to use Tuffers over the wicket into the rough, and he put the break on.
Yes, I was going to say, that period between tee and the close of play on the third day was a really crucial period for you, because you seemed to find a little formula there.
Yeah, tough as bowled over the wicket. There's a bit of rough there, got a bit of spin. We had a packed leg side field, and, you know, for a right-handed batsman, your scoring options are limited, as we find with Shane Warne when he bowls into our leg stump.
Right, well, I don't want to spoil your afternoon, but I want to show you a couple of dismissals you might like to talk us through in a moment. We'll just watch this one from Tim May, and then we'll show you Alex Stewart's dismissal. That one outside off stump. Have a look at this one and talk us through it.
Well, he'd set him up the ball before and bowled a short wide one, which he cut for four, and that was a classic leg spinner's dismissal, really. He bowled a flipper. Stewie didn't read it. He wouldn't have played the shot had he read the flipper. Unfortunately, he didn't, and it got through his defence.
Yes, it was as good. Oh, he's dropped him. That one's gone straight back to May. He's been waiting for a miss hit there. Let's have another look at that one. One went in the air around about mid-wicket area early on, but he's mishit this one, Graham. And yes, he got his hands to it. He should have caught that one, Tim May. So that's a bit of a letter for Graham Gooch. However, he's the sort of player, if you let him off, anything could happen. May again. Yes, the next dismissal was yours. That was a pretty good delivery as well.
Yeah, I think I slightly misread the length. I should have been forward. I went back, and it was a normal leg break, and I just expected it to turn more than it did, and it kind of got onto me a bit quick and through the defence again.
The other problem, I suppose, with the leggies, with Warne especially, is that he bowls a big spinning leggy, and that one was one of those that tended to dip a little bit and not turn quite so much.
Yeah, I just expected it to be a normal leg break spinning across me, and that's why, as I read it, I played back and was waiting for the turn. But as you say, it turned a fraction, but really more or less went straight on, and that's why I missed it.
I noticed after the innings that you and Alex Stewart zipped upstairs and got the binoculars out. Are you comfortable at the moment that you're reading everything he can throw to you, Shane Warne?
He's a fine bowler. I'm not sure to say you read everything, but I'm sure the more you can, the more exposure you get, the more you see him, the better your chances are of succeeding in the future. So I just went up there and got the binos out and had a look for 20 minutes. And unfortunately, I'm quite a superstitious bloke, and when we were going for 3 hours without losing a wicket, I had to be glued to my seat upstairs without moving.
That's Warne again, and that one padded away. Well, I suppose, having scored 167 in that first innings, things were looking really bad. What has happened now, after the fight back, is that things have started to look up again, so perhaps it is going in the right direction.
Well, I hope so. We showed a lot of character and a lot of fight, and that's what you need to do. You have bad days in Test cricket, what you need to do is have the spirit to come back and show a bit of character, and the side's done that, and I hope we can battle it out this afternoon.
What about Devon Malcolm? He'll be right for the second test, no doubt.
Yeah, he's out. He came to the changing room yesterday. It was the first time we've seen him for 3 or 4 days, and it was a great lift to the side to see him.
Good. Well, thanks very much for the little chat. Look forward to seeing you in the next test match in Melbourne, fit and strong with your full attack. That's all from down here. Back to you, Richie.
Shane Warne's flipper, which was picked by Mike Gatting. I think I have a little bit of news for Michael Atherton when he says that that was Shane Warne's normal leg spinner. I think you'll find in days to come that it wasn't, that it was the top spinner, new top spinner he's been using or trying to work on, and that, as sometimes happens with that one that comes through the fingers, the leg spinner, it just turned a fraction from the leg. We did see Alex Stewart and Michael Atherton up on the scaffolding yesterday watching Shane Warne bowl very sensibly to see what happens when the ball comes out of his fingers. Bill Laurie was there as well. Recipes for pigeon pie and all sort of things being passed on to the England captain. Lancashire pigeon pot. Warne has done a good job out there today. Ball for 231 England, and that's where they remain.
Shane Warne is going to continue from the Stanley Street end. McDermott is starting to do a few loosening up exercises. The new ball is available to Captain Mark Taylor if he wants it. McDermott hasn't had a bowl this morning. I guess there is the other thought that McDermott may get a bowl from the Vulture Street end with the old ball. He started to swing the old ball around quite nicely late last evening. Feeling may be that a short, sharp blast from McDermott, perhaps aimed at Gatting more so than Gooch. Gooch has done a lot of opening in his career. The flipper. Gooch has proved over many years that he's quite capable of handling the moving ball, the swinging ball. Maybe a thought that just get at Gatting before he really gets set. Out there, maybe the bowler thought that there was some bat there.
So it might have been pad and then bat and then just away from the man in at silly point.
Now Steve Waugh is in that position because he's got